Well, hello, everyone. I'm your host, Ken Engel, president of Southeastern University, and we want to welcome you to Framework Leadership Today, a podcast about principles and ideas you can use today to take your leadership to the next level. And now we're exclusively a part of the SEU Podcast Network.
And I'm your co-host, Michael Steiner, SEU Chief of Staff.
And we are privileged today. Wow, this is an awesome privilege to introduce our guests for today's show, Bob and Rob Hoskins. Bob Hoskins is the founder of OneHope and has planted churches across the world in the Middle East, North Africa. And of course, Bob is world-renowned child evangelist, Christian missionary, author, publisher with an incredible legacy. So we're excited that you're with us today.
Well, yeah. It's my joy.
We love it. And we're also joined by Dr. Rob Hoskins, the president of One Hope, and also Bob's son. So great legacy happening there. Again, gifted missions futurist, innovative ministry strategist, relentless visionary and global connector. We're really excited to have you guys on the show
today. Wow, that was a mouthful.
It was. It hit me. Yeah.
Again, great to have you both with us. Now, One Hope, as we start our conversation, is a ministry that works in over 100 countries to send really that biblical message of hope to children through print and film and storytelling and digital apps. And this ministry partners with local churches, partners with governments, schools, and other ministries to share God's word. And it has reached 1.7 billion children and youth literally around the globe. Bob, you founded the organization back in 1987 as the Book of Hope International. Love to start our conversation by talking about how and why did you get it started?
Well, it came out of a vision. 1987, in a time of fasting and prayer, I had a vision of Satan's plan to destroy a generation. And I saw demons from hell attacking children. Wow. Through violence, through war, through famine, through disease, through the proliferation of alcohol, drugs, and all of these things. And children were being slain. And for days I was weeping, God, what is this I'm seeing and what should I do? And the Spirit of God spoke into my spirit and said, the only thing that will rescue them is truth. Mm-hmm. And truth is found in my word.
Yeah.
I want you to take my word to the children of the world. And then he said, you will do it through leaders.
Right.
Which, wow. I wasn't sure about that leader part.
No, and it's, I mean, when you present the hope of Christ, Jesus, he says, I am the way, the truth. Right. And the life. Mm-hmm. So powerful.
So how was print media specifically so critical to accomplishing that mission?
Well, at that point, 1987, I had gone as a missionary to the Middle East after spending years as a crusade evangelist. And you don't do crusade evangelism in the Muslim world. Mm-hmm. And so there was frustration. How am I going to reach these people when I can't go do a crusade? Yeah. And God by the Holy Spirit. Well, first of all, I started reading the Quran.
Right.
And I found Jesus in the Quran. Mm-hmm. So I said, what if I take Jesus from the Quran, mm-hmm, and I sort of repackage him, and reintroduce him. And so I created a few pieces of literature that did that. And then I had to say, well, how am I going to get it to people? So I put ads in newspapers. They sent me inquiries. Mm-hmm. And within 10 years, we had 400,000 people in 26 Arabic-speaking countries, mm-hmm, receiving our literature. Wow. And so that's how I was into the literature. I said, yeah, I call it the power of the printed page. Yeah. And in 1987, it was probably the most effective medium. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily true today, but in 1987, right, books were the most effective medium.
Right. So how do leaders, how can they have their eyes open for opportunities like that? Like, how do you see those kind of moments where you're like, man, if I can capitalize on this, I can accomplish that mission? How do you have your eyes open like that?
Well, keep your eyes open.
Yeah.
I've always been one that follows current trends and culture, what's happening in the various levels of life. And I think in addition to the Holy Spirit, which I accredit the vision to the Holy Spirit, I credit the idea to launch the various ministries of the Holy Spirit, but there's also that ingredient of being conscious and aware of what's going on around you,
yeah,
and responding to that, responding, mm-hmm, to the current needs, mm-hmm, and situations.
I think Dad's always been, you know, if there was a biblical dictionary and there were pictures in it and it was son of Issachar, I think my dad, mm-hmm, would be there,
yeah,
one who understands, yeah, their times, yep, and knows what to do. Mm-hmm. And there's a discipline about understanding your times and knowing what to do. I think part of it was he started preaching when he was 7 years old, never went to school after the age of second grade. Mm-hmm. I know I'm here on a Southeastern podcast, and I'm advocating for no education, you know, as a wonderful way. But what happened was he became self-taught from the time he was 7 years old. And my dad's been an avarice reader, consumer of media. And he became a lifelong learner beginning at 7 years old. And it's a discipline in his life that I've seen him every day, still at 85 years old, super disciplined, not only to be in the Word and in prayer, but also to be reading the latest thinkers, understanding where culture's going. I mean, my dad's the one that is the early adapter who's telling me, Rob, you got to download this new app. It's really going to change the way you think about things, you know. And so he's always a step ahead, and he's always stayed young in his heart. And that's what I actually love about Southeastern is what you're advocating for is not someone to come here and get a four-year degree and the relationship's over, but that Southeastern, as an institution, is here to create lifelong leaders that are continually learning, that are continually feeding their mind, continually feeding their heart and their soul with what's going on today. And that combination between being a Pentecostal institution that hears the voice of the Spirit and a lifelong learner that understands keenly what is going on in the world, I think is the combination that has been the genius behind Dad's life and ministry is to be able to, you know, leaders see early, leaders see before others see.
Yeah.
You know. And then I think the third ingredient is they act.
Right.
You know, you can, the Holy Spirit can give you a vision. You can see things cleanly and awarely, but some people are measure, never cut.
Right.
And, you know, a vision without action is just a dream.
Mm-hmm.
But Dad's been able to say, okay, we see things clearly. We've got a plan. Let's get busy and get something done.
And it's really, it's about the stewardship of life. Steward, being a good steward of calling and having, listening, understanding context, all of that. And that's what you do in a pretty profound way. Now, One Hope continues to expand and fulfill its destiny by reaching millions, showing the world that, again, its mission was not man's idea, but indeed a direct calling from God. Now, Rob, you helped launch a 44-country research initiative named Spiritual State of World's Children. That was back in 2007. This was to help One Hope learn more about the unique needs and experiences and social traditions of children and youth literally around the world. What inspired you to start that initiative?
Yeah, it goes back to, it really goes back to when Mom and Dad, and Dad was fairly young, and sort of at a leadership perspective, at the peak of his leadership ability as the leader CEO of One Hope. And he turned to me when I was younger than 40 years old and said, it's time for me to hand this over to you. And I was like, Dad, you're, you know. But he said, no, he said, if we're going to lead the ministry on to the next generation, then I need to begin to serve you and be behind you, encouraging you. And so you can imagine the tremendous weight that my wife Kim and I felt as young leaders to take what my mom and dad had really spent their entire lives building, this incredible ministry, global ministry, and the impact it was already having around the world, and saying, Lord, if we're going to build on this foundation, what is it you're saying to us as a new generation of leaders and how we're going to lead One Hope? And the thing that was really on my heart and mind was, so we go into a community, we hand out 100,000 copies of God's Word. If we handed them out, did anyone read them? If they read them, did they understand them? If they understood it, did it affect their beliefs and attitude? If it affected their beliefs and attitude, then are we seeing any behavior change?
Right.
So this sort of science of what has become at One Hope, what we call outcome-based ministry, was the ability to say, what impact are we having with our work? Can we measure? Everybody's talking about transformation right now.
Right.
Very few people are measuring transformation. And if you don't do research, you really have no ability to measure your outcomes.
Right.
You don't know what your starting point is, so how do you know if there's been any change?
Mm-hmm.
So research under my leadership really became the cornerstone of One Hope moving to what we call outcome-based ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And so we've only had three major vision shifts since Dad founded the ministry. And we moved from being a product-driven ministry, the books, the print, the product. And of course, you know, that had tremendous impact. But then we made the strategic decision to move from not in any way abandoning product-driven, but really being focused on what we call market-driven. Mm-hmm. So, and if you don't understand your market, it's back to what your question was, what do you do in the Middle East when you can't go preach a crusade? That's always been market-driven, but it really became the focus of everything we do. So research became sort of the capstone of that second transition for us. And so we started launching into research, and we've really become, OneHope is probably, arguably, the largest researcher of beliefs and attitudes of children and youth around the world. So we have a massive research department. We have five PhDs on there that are that are helping us, and we're continually. So that was the first one, the attitudes and belief of youth, spiritual state of the world's children. I mean, we're talking about a massive study. I mean, this was 42 countries. We had 250,000 participants, 155 diagnostic questions, and it really helped us understand in every market where we were working, what do the kids themselves think about these issues? And then we just finished our second one, which is which we call Global Gen Z, which is another global project to really understand, you know, how do Gen Zers think around the world, and we've seen some major shifts between the 2007 study and the 2020 study that we just completed, and now we're in our third phase of leadership and vision shift, which is we're going to become user driven. So we move from product driven to market driven to user driven, and of course the user driven comes from the fact that we live in a digital community, and we can directly market to individuals now, and so it's actually going to an individual. And if you don't have research and you don't have the capacity to use that research in a digital format, then I don't care if you're a marketer, a businessman, anybody that's selling any type of product, anybody that wants to reach consumers, they really need to be making this shift as part of the digital transformation to be able to take as much data as you can in a data-rich world in digital, be able to understand that data, and then take it down and particularize it to the individual person, to the user. So that's the journey OneHope has been on in our in our development. But research still sits at the core. And here's the amazing thing. When we told the board we want to move from product-driven to market-driven, they said, wow, that's going to be expensive. Research is an expensive proposition. It might break our business model. And my proposition back to the board was, I really believe that if we understand the market better and we're bringing more value to the market, then everybody will want our products more. And actually, that happened. And the same thing is happening now with user-driven. If we understand the user better, we'll serve the market better. And so these things have actually built on one another, and the ministry has continued to grow and expand with those sort of vision shifts that we've been going through.
And you know, when we started making these shifts, my original partners, who were the donors, I'd preach to them the power of the printed page, the power of the printed page, the power of the seed. And suddenly they said, well, don't you still believe, you know, don't you still believe that God's word will never return void and blah, 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 blah?
Why do you have to do all this
research? Why you spend all this? I said, let's look like this. If I could fly over a village with a bundle of scripture and just kick them out of the plane and let them flutter down and hope that somebody will pick them up and hope that they can read it and then hope that they will understand it and then hope that there will be a response. If that's all I could do, I believe so in the power of God's word. If that's all I could do, I'd probably do it. But what if I can land there? What if I can meet the people? What if I can learn their language? What if I can understand their culture? Then I can go to the scripture and fashion a message that will engage them. Now, isn't that better? And they said, oh, yeah, maybe that's better.
That's so, and that's such a big, powerful principle when it comes to leading change in your organization, right? That power of imagination, asking those what-if questions. As you guys have shifted these major shifts, what were some of the other things that you did to help your organization, your donors, your board catch the vision and really support where you felt like the Holy Spirit was leading you?
Yeah, I mean, great question, and not without a lot of pain. Let me just put it that
That's
way.
Right.
Leading change takes courage. You know, it's always going to upset a contingent of your stakeholders. And that's just part of being a leader. I mean, and I think that if you were going to make everybody happy, you're never going to be a change leader. So you've just got to set in your mind, this is the direction we're going. I remember when God was speaking to me about outcome-based ministry, it was really a dramatic event that kind of forces you as a leader to say you have to do this. Yeah. Because none of us willingly want to lead through change if we understand the impact that change is going to have on our community, people that we love dearly, the relationships. We did lose donors. I mean, that had supported Dad and Mom for 40 years when we started going in new directions. There are donors right now that are even very reluctant to go with us and actually designate their funds towards digital, because to them it's not as tangible for them. So these are hard decisions you make as a change leader. It was in the country of Swaziland. I was there actually to film a video, to present a video, and we always sort of have a poster child video at our big fundraising event every year. And so Swaziland looked great on paper. I mean, we were in every school in the country. The king had given us permission. We had a church that had sponsored every school. I mean, the program on paper was just, man, this is fun. We were getting great anecdotal stories of kids whose lives were transformed. So I was flying into Swaziland, never been there, to sort of film what was going on and show how wonderful, you know, One Hope is. And the reality on the ground was completely different. I mean, this was a place where David Livingston had been a missionary there. So we're talking about a rich history of mission here. All of our partners were there. World Vision was there. Compassion was there. I mean, all the denominational missions agencies were there and had been there for literally hundreds of years. And from the ride from the airport to the hotel, I was amazed. I mean, I saw Jesus billboards. I saw Jesus bumper stickers on every car. I mean, every kilometer there was a church. Wow. And I started talking to my host, a national leader there, and found out that 72% of the country claimed to be born again believers. The king actually preaches to the nation in a national stadium every year. And I'm thinking, wow, job done. I mean, why are we even here? This is a Christian nation. Oh, by the way, we have the highest HIV/AIDS rate in the world.
Wow.
Average life expectancy of a Swazi man is down to 32 years of age.
Wow.
The United Nations says this will become the first extinct nation in the world if things continue the way they are. And I couldn't sleep that night, because how could a Christian nation be dying of sexual dysfunctionalism? And what hit me in that story was, we're measuring our outputs as if they were outcomes. All of us are saying we're hitting the mark. You know, our program was saying that. I was almost sick to my stomach the next morning when I went to a school, and they're shooting a video with a principal who's giving high praise to our program. I'm standing outside with two young teachers. And you know how God just sort of sets you up in moments this? And I'd gotten the morning newspaper in Swaziland, and that's another thing Dad told me to always do. Read the local newspaper wherever you go. Understand, you're constantly doing research, right? Dad was doing research before you knew it was research. I was reading the newspaper, and the front article was about a school teacher who had sexually abused seven of his students. And so I'm standing outside with these two young teachers, and I show them this newspaper, and I say, you know, what's going on here? You know, what? And the teachers go, oh, this is very unusual. I said, it doesn't say it's unusual. And in fact, it says, you know, the vocation that has the highest number of sexual abuse are school teachers. So I said, it's not an anomaly. It sounds like it's normal. So I kept prodding these guys. Finally, one of the guys got angry at me. And he looked at me. He said, do you have a car? I said, yeah, I have a car. He says, do you have a house? I said, yeah, I have a house. He says, are you married? I go, yeah, I'm married. He said, does your wife have a car? I go, yeah. He says, I don't have a wife. I don't have a car. I don't have a house. All I have is these girls.
Wow.
This public school teacher is admitting to me that he's sexually abusing his students. Well, I shut our program down that day. Yeah. I said,
now that's leadership.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
When you have something that everybody in the world thinks you're highly successful, and you say it's not working, we're going to shut it down. That's what leaders do. Wow. Sorry.
And so I said, until we figure this out, we're not moving forward. And that's where my vision for outcome-based ministry and moving to being market-driven rather than product-driven began. And it was a hard road. I mean, you don't want to admit to your stakeholders we failed.
Yeah.
That's leadership.
Right.
Is transparently being able to communicate to people, this is the reality of the situation, and taking everybody on that journey with you. But those stories have to be communicated, and story is powerful. Right. I could come back and try and teach outcome-based ministry and convince people that this is the right way to go. I can tell one story mm-hmm. that has impacted my life and tell it well, and I can move the culture.
Yeah.
And so it's like Drucker says, mm-hmm. I mean, culture eats a vision for breakfast.
Right.
I mean, and culture is built around narrative. It's built around these powerful stories. And so Kim and I and my daughters, we moved there for 3 months to Swaziland to do research. Mm-hmm. And it was startling. I had a young girl who'd been through our program, had received our material in school, accepted Christ. And so I'm interviewing her and saying, you know, what outcome has happened? And she turned to me and asked me, 13-year-old girl asked me a question. She goes, I still have a question. She goes, do I sleep with the bus driver once a month? Mm-hmm. Or do I walk 7 kilometers to school every day?
Wow.
I mean, what she was, and I had to unpack that, yeah. that question. And what she was saying to me was, in this country, the cultural narrative is, growing up as a poor girl, the only chance your family has to make its way out of poverty is your education. Mm. And for her not to sleep with the bus driver in that cultural context, so she was being a good little girl.
Mm-hmm.
She was taking one for the team.
Right.
And just the demonic nature sure. of that situation, the evil, mm-hmm. the persistent evil that was there. Now, I'm an American, mm-hmm. so my first reaction is, let's start a bus company. I mean, you know, I mean, this little girl needs, I mean, we're hammers. Every nail we see, we're going right, to hit it, right? Right. We're going to hit yep. it. And that's where the other component of research comes in so yep. strong, which mm-hmm. is to say, because I say outcome-based ministry is built on two foundations, research and collaboration.
Yeah.
I didn't need to start a bus company, but I needed to do research, do some asset mapping to find out. God has amazing people that are unutilized,
right.
that need leadership.
That's huge.
And so I did. I found a teen challenge couple who had already identified this need and were busing kids to the school. Mm-hmm. Long story short, if I couldn't make it work in Swaziland, what right did I have as a leader to change an entire global organization? So you have to create models that people can see for change leadership.
Mm-hmm.
You don't try and implement those changes on a broad, huge scale until you know you've come up with a winning formula, solution, process, conceptual framework. So out of that Swazi program, I developed my personal leadership for outcome-based ministry. And if I couldn't prove it in Swaziland, I wasn't going to try and implement it anywhere else. But we did. We came up with what was called the I Matter program. That I Matter program became so successful in measuring the age of sexual debut, which was the number one predictor of HIV/AIDS growth in the country. So this was what we call evidence-based in the world sociologically and in the humanitarian relief and development world. It's called evidence-based, and we were able to prove through our program called I Matter that we were able actually to affect the narrative in the minds of children and young people mm-hmm. to prolong the age of sexual debut, which actually turned what's called the R factor, the rate of growth of HIV in the country, mm-hmm. and it was so successful that USAID, CDC, the Center for Disease mm-hmm. Control. Saw our program, and we got the largest single first-time grant of over $6 million for our program in South Africa.
Yeah.
So it proved the formula to my board that, our fundraising might go down, but the value of evidence-based, outcomes-based programs would be so desired by the market mm-hmm. that they would begin to offset our other costs for distribution that we were having to do, which proved to be the case. So a long answer to your, how do you bring about change? But there's certain elements in that story. There's the power of narrative
right.
that's needed.
Yeah.
There's the power of being able to go into a single market, a smaller scale, a skunk work, whatever it is, and to be able to figure out the science of what you're trying to do so that you can go back and prove to your constituency there is a better way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
People aren't going to change unless they can have a vision for a better. Your job as yep. the leader is to be able to paint the vision of the future that's better than the existing. And if you can't do that, people aren't going to change.
Right.
Why
right.
would we? Mm-hmm. Why can we? Yeah. Why are we going to go through the pain of that?
Yep. Yep.
And after that, I came a year later, after Swaziland, I presented to our entire global community of stakeholders, and I said, this is where we're going.
Mm-hmm.
It's not an option. And I can tell you right now, some of you will not be here 2 years from now, because you're not going to buy this. Mm-hmm. You're very comfortable with where you are. God bless you. We're going to transition you out well, but we are going.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we're going hard and fast. And we're in the middle of that right now with the digital world, with going direct to user. I've got great resistance, even within my organization right now. And I've made it abundantly clear to my entire team.
Yeah.
Guys, this the train has left the
yeah,
station.
Right.
It's called a digital train, and it's moving fast.
Yeah.
And if you're not with us, God
yeah.
bless you.
Yeah, mm-hmm. No, so good. Now, we celebrated last night. We're launching the Bob and Hazel Hoskins School of Mission here at Southeastern University. Mm-hmm. you know, wanting our students to understand missiology in how it just applies to everyday life in the calling that they have. But I want to ask you this. You know, a lot of young people struggle, and our mission around here is helping them to discover and develop their divine design so they can go and serve Jesus, they can serve the church, they can serve the world. But a lot of young people can struggle to really begin discovering their calling and discovering that design. What advice would both of you give to those who are struggling to find purpose?
Well, I would say go to the scripture, and you'll discover very quickly that God has a purpose and a plan for our lives.
Right.
He didn't just create us haphazardly to, you know, hit and miss. I really believe God has a design and a purpose for our lives. And so I think as we search the scripture, and as in prayer, we ask God for direction. And then in addition to that, from the human standpoint, what are my gifts?
Right.
What are the skills that God has entrusted to me? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I may want to be a great hockey player, but I'm never going to be a great hockey player. I mean, the heavens could tell me be a hockey player, and I don't have the giftings and the skills. Mm-hmm. So you understand the giftings and skills that God has given you, and then you concentrate on improving and honing those gifts and those skills. And I believe that when you do that, then God, by the Holy Spirit, will begin to open the way for you. Mm-hmm. He will make it clear to you as you do your part.
Yeah.
I mean, Dad's always taught me from a young age, we find God's will at the confluence of our personal skills and abilities, the world's need that we can actually see that's out there, and our passion. So what are we good at? Mm-hmm. What are we passionate about? And where do we see need in the world?
Yeah.
And he's always told me, if you, at the confluence of those three things, you find God's will. Yeah. And if you do, then you don't have fear about moving forward. And that's what I think keeps a lot of, especially Gen Z from this latest research.
Yeah.
They're a very fearful generation.
Yeah.
They grew up with 9/11. Mm-hmm. They went through the crash in 2008. Mm-hmm. They're presently going through a pandemic. I mean, all they've known is insecurity in culture, society, politics. Mm-hmm. And so they're the most thoughtful generation probably since the GI generation, since my dad's generation. Mm-hmm. And so they live with a lot of fear. And so I think, but they're the most cause-oriented generation in the history of humanity.
Right.
So I found they've been very resonant to what Dad taught me, which is, what are you great at? They're also the most knowledgeable generation in the history of humanity.
Yeah.
I think what they're looking for, Ken, and what you provide here at Southeastern University is having a guide beside that can just help them to understand in their design process, what are my skills? What is it I'm really passionate about? I think they've had so much thrown at them because of social media that they sort of are passion fatigued because it's like, what is my passion of the day?
Right.
And getting them to sort of guide through, I don't have to be passionate about everything in the world. What is it at my heart and core through scripture and through the Bible that God is leading me into and really discovering what am I great at? Where is the world's need, and what am I passionate about? And then if you do that, there's sort of a fourth leg to that, and it's your vocation.
Yeah.
And your vocation, if you can find those three things, I can guarantee you, you're gonna live fine.
Yeah.
I mean, we've never, you guys are leaders. If you find a young person who has those three things, you're going to pay them.
Exactly.
I mean, you don't have to worry about whether you're going to get a paycheck or whether God's going to take care of you. Or I mean, leaders are looking for people like that everywhere. Right. You don't have to worry about your vocation, whether you're going to have economic stability or anything like that. I mean, so those four things will happen.
Yeah.
But it very much is, as Dad's been philosophy. And Dad is a student of Drucker. He Peter Drucker, the father.
Fortunately, I knew Peter and spent a lot of time with him. So he had a great impact on my life and how I conduct my ministry.
Yeah.
And so part of it is just, you know, Drucker's thing was learning how to be a knowledge worker.
Yeah.
in a knowledge economy, which we're living in. Mm-hmm. And those were really Drucker's points, mm-hmm. as far as growing in your gifts and skills and yep. in your talents,
yeah.
Being passionate enough because you're driven by a need. And I think the millennials and the boomers were driven by materialism.
Mm-hmm.
Gen Z is not.
Yeah. Right.
They're driven by cause. And where is the point of human need?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But some of them have done some really, you know, you read something on the internet and you're an expert. No, you're not.
Right.
I mean, that's why they're Southeastern University.
Exactly. Yeah.
You need to learn the science,
yeah.
you know. And just in our field, in missions, you know, everybody goes on a short-term trip for 2 weeks and they're suddenly a world expert telling me how I should change my economic development plans in countries. And I'm going, well, let me sort of guide you for a little while here. So you know, it's this, but I love Southeastern's vision of really discovering those things that we're talking about right now.
Yeah.
But not just discovering them, being a guide beside, not just for the 4 years they're here. That's why our family is so humbled, so honored that you would name this school after my mom and dad, the Bob and Hazel Hoskins School. And from the beginning, what you shared with us is the fact that your dad at 85 hasn't even finished the race well yet. He flies out to DRC this next week.
That's the Democratic Republic of the Congo.
Yeah.
Wow.
So he's headed to the Congo at 85 years of. I mean, you know, he hasn't slowing down at all. But it's this life well lived.
Right.
From the time he's 7 year old as boy preacher to 85 and off on his way to Congo after getting a school named after him. That is an adventure that is so exciting.
Yeah.
And what you said is, we want our students to have models and examples that they can follow.
Yeah.
And I think that life journey and Southeastern's vision to begin a relationship with your students now, but to walk with them and create the next generation of Bob and Hazel Hoskins around the world, that you can be in relationship and be that guide beside for the. That's why we were thrilled when Southeastern, I was thrilled.
Yeah.
It took my dad a little convincing to get us to name the school after him. But that's why we love this place.
Yeah. Ah, powerful, powerful.
And we do love this place.
And it takes me to, you know, as you describe this, the great statement that Frederick Buechner made. He said, the place where God calls you is a place where your deep gladness meets the world's deep hunger.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when you find that, wow, you are operating in your desire.
Yeah.
And that's powerful.
It's fascinating when you're talking about the differences, because I feel like, you know, 25 years ago, you have Fight Club and you have this whole generation that's marked by anger, right? That anti-consumerism.
Yeah.
And now 25 years later, we've got a generation marked by fear. And in both situations, the answer is that mentorship. It's that, hey, who's the voice in your life that's directing you, that's helping you overcome these lies, overcome these things in your life? What advice would you give to people right now that should be engaging in that mentorship relationship that doesn't? How do you start that?
Well, one thing that was shocking to us, this is the latest research, this Global Gen Z report, something very unique about this generation that was different than their older brothers and sisters, the millennials. The number one influential voice in Gen Zers is their parents.
Wow.
Far beyond the internet, far beyond social media, far beyond their friends as peers, education system, government, and actually, unfortunately, religious leaders were last.
Mm-hmm.
And this was global, by the way. And this wasn't just Christians. This was Muslim, Buddhist, Hindus, Christian kids. Gen Z globally, most influential voice in their life, by far more than any other generation, is their parents. Now, why is that? The reason is because, and this is why mental illness and anxiety are so high among Gen Z as well. I mean, it's astronomical growth in mental illness. There is so much stress because of the volume of knowledge and stimulation that's coming at them that they don't trust anybody anymore.
Yeah.
They might, you know, love a digital influencer, but they don't trust them.
No.
I mean, at the end of the day, and so they're turning to their parents. And so I really think that there's a unique opportunity for us as the church to reinstate the biblical model,
right?
Yeah. Which is the Shema,
Yeah.
From generation to generation, from parents to children. And I think we professionalize ministry so much that many parents have actually wrongfully deserted their role as being a priest of their home.
Wow.
And they haven't properly raised their children. Mm-hmm. And they haven't taught what my mom and dad taught me about what we just talked about, understanding who you are.
Yeah.
I think the church has abdicated their role in that regard as well. You know, we allow secular, humanistic, in many cases, school counselors to help tell our children where they should go to college. No, this is our responsibility.
Right.
These are our children.
Right.
And this is what the scripture has taught us from the very beginning. It's why Judaism has maintained itself as a persecuted community through mm-hmm. thousands of years, because they have not abandoned the responsibility as a community to say, we will take responsibility for our own children. So I think we're living in a very unique time in history.
Mm-hmm.
And so we at One Hope are completely changing our philosophy of ministry to really equip. Now, here's the scary thing out of the research study. Young people say that parents are their most influential voice in their life, except for one area, and that's sexual identity.
Hmm.
They don't believe their parents understand the reality of sexual identity. These are hard issues, guys. Hmm. I mean, they didn't teach me in seminary about gender identification. Well, this was not a big field of study when I was, you know. So that's the only topic that they don't fully, and peers are where they're going to talk about. Mm-hmm. Well, shame on us.
Mm-hmm.
Shame on the church for not talking about these issues.
Right.
Shame on parents.
Right.
Now, the scary thing was we did qualitative research with the parents and showed them this data and said, parents, you are the most influential voice of your... They were shocked, number one. They thought, I'm the most influential voice? My 13-year-old boy doesn't even look like he looks like he's looking at me when I'm talking to him. He doesn't sound... They're listening to you.
Right.
They're watching you.
Right.
You are the most influential voice in their family. Then when this realization hit them in qualitative research, they said, I feel completely ill-equipped. I can't answer their questions.
Yeah.
They have so much knowledge. They're asking me questions I don't have answers to.
Yeah.
And I think the problem there is that we haven't properly catechized our people. We haven't actually trained and discipled our people on the questions of the day and to have a biblical answer for everything, as 1 Peter 3 says.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so this, again, is where I see the role of the university.
Mm-hmm.
I see the role of the university to say there are lifelong learners out there. And Southeastern is offering a full range of certificate programs. If you're a parent out there and you want to dig deeper on issues of human sexuality,
right.
on the economy,
right.
on creation care, on these issues that Gen mm-hmm. Z are asking the hardest questions that have ever been asked in the history of humanity, Southeastern is here to walk alongside you as parents, as pastors, as youth ministers, as children's pastors,
mm-hmm.
as business leaders,
mm-hmm.
to be able, hey, business leaders out there, you better have social answers for your employees. We're learning every day in the corporate world. If you don't have proper social answers,
mm-hmm.
They don't care how big their bonus check is going to be this year.
Mm.
This generation wants to know, what do you believe? Why do you believe it? And can you give me answers?
Yeah.
What a great place for the church to be in right now. But it's going to take us living up to these hard questions that culture is asking us and walking along this next generation to supply them with the answers.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why we need academic institutions.
Yeah. Well, we're incredible conversation we're having today, and we're going to move into our fire round here. But I want to ask one more question before we move in that fire. You just wrote a book with John Maxwell. Tell us a little bit about that.
Who's John Maxwell?
Who is John Maxwell?
Is John Maxwell? I was actually sitting on a boat with John, and he's been a mentor to me, and we were down on a boat in Fort Lauderdale, and we're cruising the intercoastal, and I just finished my doctoral dissertation on this whole subject of change and transformation. Mm-hmm. And he had read it, and I, as a mentor, I just said, hey, John, I want to know if there's a popular book in this dissertation.
Yeah.
You know, I just, you guys know how hard it is.
Yeah.
I mean, blood, sweat,
absolutely.
Tears over this dissertation. Maybe eight people are going to read it, you know.
Yeah.
I said, is there a popular book here? And he said, not only is there a popular book here, he said, I'd like to write it with you.
Yeah.
Would you write the book with me?
And you said, let me have a day or two to think about
think
it.
About it.
Yeah. Right.
Just a bit of advice for our listeners. I know this is a leadership podcast. When John Maxwell ask you if he will write a book with you, I said, let me think about it. Yes.
I
say it took 2.4 seconds. John said, that's too long. He said, you waited too long. You almost lost me. So of course, I mean, this guy is, you know, probably the leading leadership guru of our time. And I frankly asked John. I said, John, you don't need me. I mean, you know, I write a book. I did write a book, and you know, I was very happy to sell 20,000 copies. You know, John's going to sell hundreds of thousands, millions of copies of it. And so I said, why? Why me? Why now? Why? And he said, I am. My entire life has been about how can we create change leaders? How can we create transformational leaders? And he said, I looked around the world and I saw someone who had actually implemented how to change your world and to create a conceptual framework and a science of transformation. He goes, I need a scientist to write this book with me. And so... so I was thrilled because it's taken, you know, I've had my head down doing this now for and with Dad for both of us for 50 years, how to bring about transformational change. John has been in the business of popularizing leadership. So together we came together and wrote Change Your World, which is a combination of John taking what are in some cases very complex change management, transformation science, and John is the genius of making things simple. Of making it accessible. And so that's what Change Your World is all about. And it's had a phenomenal response. I mean, John's saying it's his best-selling book in recent times that he's written. And so I'm thrilled. And
they're in Paris today to introduce the French version.
Yeah, the French book came out today. So
today, they're in Paris today.
How many languages is it going?
13 right now. So, si vous êtes en France aujourd'hui, je recommande cet livre pour toi. So, just a little endorsement for the French book out there.
There we go.
All your French listeners.
Yes. And we have a lot of them. Hey, again, grateful for you both. Now we want to kind of transition to our quick fire round, and we want to ask you just a few questions surrounding
that's scary.
Kind of everything we discuss. You will master this well, yes. So we know you'll do this good. We want to grab just some applicable pieces for our listeners to just run with. So, Michael, why don't you ask the first question?
All right. So what are the top three topics that every leader should be informed about right now and prepared to discuss? In your opinion.
Whoa, the top three right now?
Right now.
Yep. Crypto.
Crypto, okay. Yep.
Absolutely. That's the first one that comes to my mind. The impact of COVID on changing direction. How is it going to affect you and what you do? Mm. Not just your family, but your business. And let me see, third one. Wow. Can't think of a third one. Those are the two most important in my mind
now. Yeah. So I would definitely say digital transformation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How is digital going to affect every aspect of life? I would say with Dad, crypto. I don't think people understand that blockchain and really decentralized finance.
Right.
Crypto is just a product of decentralized systems. Is critical if you're going to be a global leader moving forward. And I would say. Probably the third issue is issues of human sexuality and gender. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is what the questions this generation is asking. So those would be my three.
Next question, and I want to revisit a statement you made earlier. What is the difference between an output and an outcome?
So I tell people there are no outcomes without outputs.
Okay.
So I'm not disparaging outputs. Outputs is a measurement of activity. And outcomes are a measurement of change.
Okay.
So we measure outputs. Yeah. I mean, this year we'll reach 135 million kids through our 320 programs. We love numbers.
Mm-hmm.
But numbers they tell part of the story. But until you measure what happened with that output, you really haven't measured an outcome.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to measure your outputs if you want to reach scale. And we do. The vision was God's word, every child.
Yeah.
But outcomes are measuring the impact of those outputs.
Yeah. Yeah, so good.
Cool. If there was a book other than Change Your World, which would be a good one, that you would recommend to young leaders right now, what would you put on there?
Oh, my gosh. So many right now. I have a revolving list on my Kindle of about 15 books that I'm reading all at the same time. So one book right now. Go ahead, Dad, and Al. I'm trying to pick the best one right now.
A book called Lead.
Okay.
By Tripp.
Paul Tripp.
Yep. Paul Tripp.
Love it.
And it may seem that it's for more mature or older leaders, but I say for young people, read it now so you don't have to read it later.
There we go. Wow, that's good.
That's good. Wow,
and good. I guess it's my turn, right?
Yep.
I've got to choose one book. Wow. I think N.T. Wright's biography of Paul is essential reading right now of your church leader.
Love it.
Yeah, I think N.T. Wright is able to take the person of Paul and make him so approachable to everybody. And I've never read a better exposition of the life of Paul than N.T. Wright's right now.
Yeah, wow, so good. Well, Bob and Rob, I want to thank you both for joining us today on Framework Leadership Podcast. I mean, Bob, you are a true hero of the faith. You both are heroes of the faith, and just, I mean, you've been obedient and faithful to God's call. And look at the fruit of that, and it's amazing. And now the School of Mission is going to be able to come alongside thousands of students to infuse that very same commitment to calling, and we're excited about it.
Let me join, as Rob already has said, how excited we are. As you know, I've always been reluctant to allow my name to be put on something because I've always worked from the premise you can have reward or recognition, and I always chose reward.
Sure.
But when you, friends here at Southeastern, described how you truly wanted to affect mission, and it's important to know it's not the School of Missions, yeah. It's the School of Mission.
Mm-hmm.
And which means that every area of life, whether it's your business school or your medical school or whatever, it's being infused with mission vision,
and
I'm so thrilled and thankful for it.
Wow, great.
I love it. Awesome. Rob, if we want to grab a copy of Change Your World, Kindle, Amazon, across the board, where everybody can get it.
Available everywhere in 13 languages right now. And if it's not in the language that you want, just send me an Instagram and I'll get it in that language for you.
It's
literally available everywhere.
Love it. Love it. And if you want to stay up to date with also One Hope, you can follow them on Instagram at One Hope Ministry. You can also keep up with Rob and Bob at Rob Hoskins on Instagram and at Rob Dean Hoskins on, that's Instagram and then Twitter right there. And if you are watching us on YouTube right now, now's a great time to hit that like button, hit that subscribe button so you can get leadership content directed to your feed every single week. And if you want to check out more leadership content, check us out on Kent_Engel at Instagram or Twitter, Kent Engel. And then if you want to get leadership content to your inbox every single week, go to kentengel.com, sign up for our Framework Leadership newsletter, and we'd love to support you on that way. Thank you so much for listening to Framework Leadership.
Take care, everybody.